No. No, I haven't seen Marini at all.
She took the scenic route?
No. No.
I do not see her.
Want me to just ad lib?
Coaches have arrived. They're a little uptight. Have a good one, bud.
Yeah, man.
Wrap it up. Rock and roll. Let's
Knocked out cold. See that? Rick Crawford got knocked out cold on the opening tip-off last night at Barclays.
No.
Yeah. Had to carry him off on a stretcher. Rick Crawford, referee. Barclays, Vanderbilt, I don't know who they were playing. LaSalle? Yeah. Yeah, so Marini just disappeared. We'll do it live! You gotta respect Disney. They cut together a little, oh, this is for all the teams. I thought it was just for Ryder and Santa Clara. I was like, that's impressive. Okay. Okay. Who are we seeing first?
Okay. To make an opening comment before that?
Okay. Oh. Kai Healy's starting for Santa Clara. You guys have that? Number 10 is starting. That's new. Okay. Okay. Well, where is she? I don't understand how it takes her so long to get from the production center out here. Now Khalil Thomas is wearing zero again.
Oh, he is?
Yeah. What the hell? You gotta love Ryder. Okay. Hey, Dave, do you know how many seats this holds? I think it's more than five, right? I think it might be like in the sevens.
Ray, how you doing?
And welcome once again to the Orlando Classic on the grounds of the Walt Disney World Resort in Lake Buena Vista, Florida. This morning, it's some Sunday morning basketball. The Broncos and the Bronx, Santa Clara, taking on Ryder in the seventh place game from inside the HP Fieldhouse here at the ESPN Wild World of Sports. Rich Hollenberg, Tim Welsh, and Tim, both of these teams coming into this consolation game 0-2, and very important in these early pre-conference tournaments to at least try to walk away with one win so you can leave with your head held high and a little momentum.
Well, Kerry Keating and Kevin Baggett kind of walked in. I watched them walk in. They're walking in a little bit light of step this morning because they're nervous, because you don't want to leave here 0-3. Certainly, you know, the psyche of your team is so important, but the psyche of their team should have been built back up on the off day yesterday. Hopefully both coaches got to their teams and said, listen, even though this game's 10:30 in the morning and it's the seventh place game, whatever, it still counts in the win column, so we got to go get one. And for Santa Clara, they just need their guards to be very aggressive offensively. And for Ryder, it's really about a balance of their bigs have played well here. They need better play from their guards.
Santa Clara declared the road team. They're going to be wearing their road reds. In the home whites, it's the Ryder Broncos, the Bronx, as they like to be called. You can make that bold prediction at the start of this game. Guarantee you the Bronx will win this game.
How about you going out on the limb early on a Sunday morning, Rich?
Ryder from out of the Metro Atlantic Athletic Conference. Santa Clara, the West Coast Conference. East meets West on a Sunday morning.
Now, Kevin Baggett feels like his guards are better than they have played. Zedrick Sadler, Teddy Okorafor, and Jimmy Taylor. Really, coming into the season, they thought they were the strength of this team, but here in Orlando, they played poorly.
Here's Okorafor off the window. No good, and Brandon Clark comes away with the ball. In the corner, jumper good. And that's a great sign when Jared Brownridge gets off early. He's had a slow tournament.
Well, aggression by the Santa Clara guards, so important and key because of their lack of inside players. They've had the injuries to their two bigs, but Clark and Brownridge and Denzel Johnson have to be aggressive.
Brownridge had 12 in the opening round against Tennessee, but only 7 against Rhode Island on Friday. Here's Thomas, tried the bounce pass to Lopez, got knocked away.
A little big fella can't put the ball on the floor, especially against that zone. Too crowded in there.
Brownridge, 2 for 2 for Jared Brownridge. And a quick timeout from Kevin Baggett.
Well, Kevin Baggett is immediately into Matt Lopez's face. Like, what are you doing trying to bounce the ball in the middle of the paint like you're a small guard? You're 7 foot, just turn and pop it in with that left-handed hook. And Santa Clara, their guards have spaced the floor. Ryder in that zone. And just a simple pitch back. Brownridge just set his feet, nobody covering or contesting.
Jarrett Brownridge, a 6'2 sophomore out of Aurora, Illinois, was the West Coast Conference newcomer of the year last year and came in as the second leading scorer, but as we touched on a little bit earlier, has struggled. He's someone that Kerry Keating feels like he needs to be a little bit nastier on the floor, maybe take a little bit more selfishness onto the floor.
Yannick Antonga out for the year with the ACL. The big fella, I mean, they need some leadership from their veterans out there on the floor. And Brown is just a young player, but he's very promising. I think he's going to be a big factor today.
That's the second Rider turnover. Went off Okorafor's knee, backcourt violation. It'll be Broncos basketball.
Well, early, you would know that Rider is the East Coast team, and they're working a nice 10:30 start. That's when you usually practice or go to brunch. But Santa Clara, it's 7:30 in the West, but they came ready with a lot of energy.
And then they've been on the road for a while already, having to play at Michigan State before heading here to Orlando. Looks like no jet lag from Santa Clara so far.
No, good ball movement, good spacing, very energized, driving, kicking. Shooters are ready to attack.
Johnson tried to force it inside the teeth of that Broncos defense and got knocked away. It'll be Santa Clara basketball under their own hoop. Four on the shot clock. Johnson forces it. Too strong. Okorafor with the rebound.
Right, better job coverage on the zone. Shifts, communication, and activity.
First touch for Lopez, and he gets fouled and will go to the line. If anything positive comes out of this Orlando Classic for Kerry Keating, it's the emergence of the not only the guard play, but certainly defensively they've been challenged, to say the least, and Matt Lopez is going to be a big handful for them without their bigs.
Well, Ryder has to be happy as well with the development of Lopez. Khalil Thomas looks like he's going to be a keeper in the MAC this year as a sophomore, so those two as a 4-5 I think are rock solid for Ryder at their level in their league, and the key really has to be the play of their guards. It's been really poor this weekend, and I think watching tape and talking to their coaches, they feel like their guards are going to be their strength, so if they can get them playing well today, it'll be a great sign moving forward.
Lopez 0 for 2 from the line in the early going. As Brandon Clark misses, Lopez clears with the rebound. Bronx looking for their first bucket. Jimmy Taylor, number 3 in white. Inside Lopez, he's shown the ability to use both shoulders in the low post. Okorafor, too strong. Brownridge, the rebound.
Not a good look, though, by Okorafor.
Nice pass.
Into a bucket.
Clark to Hubbard. And the freshman, Matt Hubbard, has his first two.
That's what happens, Rich. Your point guard drives down to the baseline, kind of takes a wild shot. You have no backcourt coverage on the defensive end, and Santa Clara took advantage.
One thing these two teams share in common in the first couple of games, as we see Lopez knock down that pretty little turnaround right-hand jump hook, is that they've both been prone to long stretches of lacks of offense.
Yeah, they're both challenged, but Ryder, they go through Lopez. That'll open up everything on the perimeter because he is a formidable inside guy. And he's got a big mismatch against Santa Clara's bigs.
Lopez, the only player in the first two games to score in double figures in both games for Ryder. As Okorafor comes away with the rebound and wants the push. Nice follow by Thomas. That's number 0 in white, Khalil Thomas, who wore 0 in the first game, then switched to 42 for the second game, now back to 0 for this third game.
I like Khalil Thomas. I think he's got activity. He's unselfish, pretty good passer. Got it as the 4-man for Ryder. Maybe slide to the 5 if needed, and Ryder trying to scratch back into this, but Santa Clara hot early.
Your
Marini.
Fans, please welcome to the court, Alex and Jordan. They are participating in today's Six Night Pack Your Bag Challenge. Alex and Jordan, what you must do is run over here, stuff the basketball in the Six Night Backpack, put the Six Night Backpack completely on, both straps, not one strap. Take the other basketball, make a move. You ready? My marks.
Okay. Okay. Just one of the many winning attractions at Walt Disney World Resort. That's the Seven Dwarfs Mine Train. Sleepy, dopey. No Timmy on that ride, though.
No, thank you. I like to keep my feet on the ground.
Cinderella's Castle in the background as we are 15:49 into this game. Santa Clara with an 8-4 lead and a nice no-look.
Well, transition basketball, it's important to keep looking ahead, but when your bigs, if they rim run and they can get ahead of the field, you got to pitch it to them, make sure they have some little room, no traffic, and the big fella Lopez was on the trail. But Ryder, a little more feisty the last couple possessions on defense, more active on the perimeter.
Ryder was tied with Georgia Tech on Friday at 30 at the half. Really gave the ACC's Yellow Jackets their money's worth. There's Denzel Johnson, Brownridge, his third triple try, in and out. And we've got a foul underneath the basket.
Case of Matt Hubbard working a little bit harder than Ryder's inside backline protection in that zone. And standing around a little bit. I mean, Khalil Thomas is very active. It's something out of their guards, though, helping out on the glass in that zone.
Tim, you mentioned Santa Clara missing Yanni Katanga so dearly. The fifth-year senior, the heart and soul of this team, the big man, will be gone for the season. So they're expecting big things from Matt Hubbard, and he's got to come along a lot quicker than probably Kerry Keating anticipated.
Well, he's just a freshman, but he's active, and that's these games. He's been solid in these games, and I think as they move forward into their league, he's going to gain a lot of experience from playing here and make sure he gets some touches, though. It looks like he can finish around the rim.
Here's Okafor to Sadler. Coming up on 5 minutes gone by in this consolation game as Anthony D'Orazio gets sent out of bounds. He's one of the first subs off the bench for Kevin Baggett. And there's a look at Atanga. They're really going to be counting on him, and instead they're going to go very guard heavy in their lineup.
Well, when it rains, it pours, and you lose your bigs to injury. All the planning you do all summer, it just crushes you. And Kerry Keating has been not a positive outlook, but he understands. You can only do what you can do. But their guards today have been pretty active, especially defensively.
Brownridge cleared. Okorafor has not had the touch with the long-range jumper. Brownridge drive and kick. Here's Evan Wardlow, number one in red. 10 on the shot clock. Brownridge, too strong. Sadler comes away with it.
Right, great job on their shifts and communicating. They seem to wake up very quickly here in this ballgame.
Pretty clear that Jared Brownridge got the message from his coach about being a little more interested in hunting his own shot.
Well, both teams playing very hard right now, focused, a lot of communication on the court.
Extra pass, seven to shoot, inside, Fortnot, and he gets called for the traveling violation. Junior Fortnot And that's the third turnover of the game for Ryder.
Well, those bigs, they just want to dribble. Just because the ball has air in it doesn't mean you're allowed to dribble it. They take the ball and bounce and bounce. With every bounce, another defender gets closer. They've got to be ready to make that pass.
You would think that Ryder would be making a concerted effort to get the ball inside. Distinct size advantage for the Bronx. Brownridge tried to force it inside, picked off by Lundy. Sadler, transition three. Short. Lundy picks it up and he'll have a chance at a three-point play.
That was good push and transition, and Zedrick Sadler just cannot buy one to save his life. He's got his feet set, he squared up, took a nice-looking jumper, but Lundy on the backside, just a lot of hustle, and Santa Clara just didn't put a body on him, slivered in for the putback.
Lundy, a 6'7 sophomore out of Fallsboro, New Jersey. Ryder located in Lawrenceville, New Jersey. He completes the three-point play, and it's 9-7 Santa Clara. There's Jalen Richard, number 5, who's checked in. He's joined in the backcourt by the leading scorer for the Broncos, number 3, Brandon Clark. Ten to shoot. Good hands by D'Orazio. Up ahead, Sadler. In and out again.
Sadler got a feel for him. He's doing everything right but finishing.
Wardlow off the window, no good. Here's D'Orazio. Inside, nice look. And Xavier Lundy again has a chance at a three-point play.
A very nice pass by D'Orazio on the look inside. And Lundy just moving without the basketball, and Santa Clara just turning their head and not playing between the ball and man. You see just on a little backcourt cut, backdoor cut to the rim, and just slid in there, and Kratz just turned his head and didn't body up inside. And Lundy, good finish.
As part of the non-bracketed Orlando schedule, Ryder had the pleasure of taking on Kansas before they came down to Orlando, and Lundy had 15 points against the Jayhawks. Now Ryder takes their first lead of the game.
Well, they've changed defenses. They started in the zone. Now they've been much more aggressive playing the man-to-man activity. It's helped the rebounding as well.
Clark off to the left. Out of bounds, it'll be Ryder basketball. We're in the consolation bracket of the Orlando Classic, and over on the championship side, oh boy, a little bit of late March in late November coming up on ESPN at 1 p.m. 11th-ranked Kansas, 20th-ranked Michigan State. We'll be talking about this game at halftime a bit. Give us a little teaser. What do you think about that?
It blows my mind. You're walking in here, 75 degrees. You should be going out to the amusement park. Instead, we're going to be heating it up in here at 1 o'clock. And you know, both teams have shot the ball very, very well. And Denzel Valentine for Tom Izzo, just tremendous against Marquette. Kansas is going to have to find somebody to check him. And they have become kind of a perimeter team this year at Michigan State. But Kansas, just a lot of depth, a lot of length in the backside.
Denzel Valentine had back-to-back career scoring nights in the first two games of this tournament. Taylor, short on the three. Lundy, who's provided a big burst off the bench, gets the offensive board. D'Orazio tried to force it inside to Sean Valentine. Foul's going to be called on Santa Clara, and we'll take a timeout. 11:16 to go. The Bronx lead the Broncos by one.
Who?
Bronx.
Did you say something?
Bronx leads the Blackhawks.
Rich Hollenberg, Tim Welsh inside the HP Fieldhouse at the ESPN Wide World of Sports at the Walt Disney World Resorts in Lake Buena Vista, Florida. Ryder with a one-point lead over Santa Clara, 10-9, and the Bronx defense has helped their offense.
Well, they came out of the locker room. They weren't ready to play at the start, and Kevin Baggett called quick timeout, changed defense, went from zone back to man, and the man has really helped their energy. They've been active on the ball, good ball pressure, good help, and recover, and then their pressure has turned Santa Clara over and also forced them into some tough shots and re-energized Ryder and also helped their offense because they've got some buckets out of transition as well.
Kevin Baggett in his third year with the Bronx out of the MAC. Coming in at 2-4. Talked to him about his coaching influences. He was an assistant coach for 16 years. Dennis Felton, Bruiser Flint, among those who he shared a bench with.
Tommy Dempsey, now the coach at Binghamton, did a tremendous job at Ryder. And the Ryder's a chance to get into the middle or upper part of this league. It really depends on their guards. Iona, Manhattan, Monmouth is going to be on the rise this year. Siena is an excellent team.
Number 3-4-3. No good from Jimmy Taylor. Out of bounds, Santa Clara basketball.
Well, that was good offense, and Taylor can knock down that shot. It's just that seemingly nothing has gone in all weekend for Ryder from the perimeter.
Zero in red for Santa Clara. Stephen Edwards checks in. He's a 6'2 freshman out of Muskegee, Oklahoma. Hasn't played a lot of minutes for Kerry Keating, but again, with a depleted bench, he's getting to see some of his reserves and how they respond to tournament play.
I like this by Kevin Baggett. A little scramble defense. Off the miss. 1-2-2 pressure. Back to the zone.
Hubbard lost control off the bounce pass. And we're going the other way.
Well, Ryder's defense has been very feisty. I like Kevin's scheme is that trying to keep Santa Clara off balance. Don't let them get comfortable at all out on the floor offensively.
Santa Clara came out hot, but has cooled off considerably since. Only 3 points and no field goals in 6 minutes and 14 seconds. Coming up on 10 minutes gone by in the first half. 10-9, Ryder with the lead and the ball. And Sean Valentine stepped on the baseline. Fourth turnover for the Bronx.
Again, the Bakes trying to dribble down low. I mean, Valentine played well the other night, and he just gave them a big lift against Georgia Tech. He's got that ability. He's moving without the basketball. He's just got to rise up and finish inside.
Here's Brownridge. Edwards. In and out. Cue the offensive board. Brownridge for three. Looked good off his hands, but was a little strong, and a foul on the rebound. No. Santa Clara out of the West Coast Conference, obviously always having to contend with the likes of Gonzaga, the 400-pound gorilla, if you will, in that conference.
Well, BYU now being in that league as well, and St. Mary's has always been at the top, but Santa Clara just trying to find an identity. And Gary Keating talked about it. He says, you know, we haven't given our guys roles yet because we're just trying to get comfortable playing with each other right now without the two bigs, with the two bigs being out.
Hubbard double team, then he turns it over out of the double team. Taylor, step through. Yes. Jimmy Taylor has his first two of the game.
Well, the pressure has Santa Clara playing a little bit too fast, and they have not settled into any rhythm on the offensive end, and that's because of Ryder's defense.
Number 10, Kai Healy. Number 20, Denzel Johnson, check back in for Kerry Keating. It's been a 12-1 run in the last 7 minutes for the Ryder Bronx. Here's Khalil Alford, number 15 in white. Nice pass to Taylor. Can't convert. Clark doing it himself.
That's the senior that Kerry Keating knows he has out there on the floor, and that's what he wants him to do. Be more aggressive with that attitude that I can finish at the rim.
Averaging 17 and a half a game is Brandon Clark. Inside Lopez, haven't called his name in a while. The left hand is good.
Well, he's been on the bench, and he came back in. He's gassed a little bit because he's played a lot of minutes. They've asked him to do a lot, but he's got a good-looking left hand, ability to carve out space, and they need to keep going through him.
Right now, he's the best thing to come out of this Orlando Classic trip for Kevin Baggett's club. DeRozio to rebound. Taylor weaving through and leaving it for Lopez. Two quick buckets for the seven-footer out of New Jersey. He has six, and Ryder up by five, 16-11.
Well, Ryder has this lead because of their defense, but it's also energized their offense as well. Just pushing it off the miss and attacking, and nobody stops the ball for Santa Clara, and Lopez finishes as Santa Clara just stands and watches. Way too easy. The big fella.
When we talk about standing and watching, I took a peek over at Kerry Keating's huddle there. He called timeout. He was separated from the huddle, talking to his guard, number 23, Jared Brownridge, very calmly explaining some of the defensive principles that haven't been executed so far. He has a young team, and he knows that it's going to be a process. He told us yesterday, hopefully these early games pay off in February, but really and realistically, they'll pay off 2 years down the road.
That's pretty simple, though. I mean, that's transition defense. You stop the dribbler, slow him down before he gets ahead of steam, and then everybody's got to get back and protect the paint. And by the way, they've got a seven-footer who's pretty good, so you better get near him. Somebody better get around him at least. Don't give him a free path to the rim.
Brownridge threw the ball away. Another Santa Clara turnover, their fifth. They trail by five with 7:51 to go. Yeah. Sure. Got it. Okay. Gotcha. Okay. Welcome back. We're at halftime between Ryder and Santa Clara. Andrew Papenfuss came to Santa Clara as the Broncos student manager, earned a spot as a walk-on, then was elected team captain this spring. everything seemed in place for a great senior season until one June day. Just coming back after this kind of thing. Got. Okay. Okay. Back at the Orlando Classic, looking forward to Kansas and Michigan State coming up following this game. That could be seen on ESPN at 1 Eastern. Jayhawks come in, ranked 11th in the country. The Spartans, 20th in the country. A couple of heavyweights going toe-to-toe in the championship game.
Perry Ellis has been very good for Bill Self this weekend. There's an array of moves around the basket, but also not the ability to knock down shots. Kansas' depth, I think, could overwhelm Michigan State possibly today, but Michigan State is kind of a different type of team. They're more offense-oriented than Tom Izzo's teams in the past. He's trying to get them to grind down and play a little bit better defense, but it'll be a fun game.
Maybe a little bit of a chip on the shoulder for Bill Self and company. They've lost the last three to the Spartans. Looking forward to that one. They try the lob. Valentine has to deliver it back out top. DeRozio, pull up. Yes. Anthony DeRozio has his first two.
Well, Danielle Marshall, the assistant coach from Ryder, grabbed DeRozio out of the last break and just kind of had a little chat with him. Just calm down, take what the defense gets you and gives you out there on the floor. He plays with a lot of emotion, but he looks pretty solid for Ryder this afternoon.
Clark, good hands by Valentine with the steal. Sadler, who struggled so far this afternoon, and those struggles continue. 0 for the field for Zedrick Sadler so far.
Okay, just has to slow down and run a little offense. They're just kind of taking the first shot that's open. And again, very quick shot selection.
DeRozio up ahead to Valentine, who couldn't get a hand on it. Tipped it out of bounds. There's Danielle Marshall, one of the better UConn players in that program's storied history. Now an assistant coach for Kevin Baggett at Ryder.
I spent some time with him this weekend and really engaged, loves the opportunity being with Kevin Baggett on his staff. And Kevin Baggett just very happy that he's got somebody of Danielle's stature because he brings a lot to the table with his experiences as a player.
Clark misses, cleared by DeRozio, and he has aspirations of head coaching one day.
Don't all assistants?
Sadler continues to struggle. Clark, the rebound.
The problem is when they actually become a head coach, you say, oh, no. Now it's all my fault.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's nice being an assistant.
And truthfully, you don't see that many big men who are former players, especially the talent level of Danielle Marshall, make that transition into head coaching. Hubbard with the nice left hand. He has five.
I think they can go into Hubbard a little bit. You know, they've got the guards on the outside who make shots, make plays, but they can't forget they've got to have a little more balance to their offense and give Hubbard some touches.
Maybe challenge Lopez, get some foul trouble. Hasn't happened yet. Here's Lopez, kicks it back out. Taylor. Short.
Wow. That's a horrible shot.
Brownridge on the curl. He hit his first two threes and has been quiet since. 0 for his last four.
They're passing around the perimeter against his zone, but they need to try to dribble drive in the gaps and then kick back out, and guys like Taylor will be open on the kick out.
DeRozio for three. Too strong. Valentine offensive rebound. Last two games, he's been a real positive player. Lopez! The bump and the bucket.
Big fella, Matt Lopez, knows how to carve out space and also demand the ball. But here, you'll see Sean Valentine does a good job of recognizing that. But look, the delivery, Rich, is absolutely perfect. He pitches it to his left shoulder. If he's throwing it on the inside, the defender was there, but he threw it exactly where he was open, where he demanded the ball, and where he could finish the play.
That was the second foul on the freshman, Matt Hubbard, so he takes a seat on the bench. Matt Lopez has a chance at a three-point play.
Loretta did a good job of spacing the floor for around Lopez. And again, they're not going to guard him one-on-one coverage. He's going to dominate, and if they pitch it in and they double him, then that will open things up on the perimeter for the guards.
Lopez 4 field goals in the first half, but he's 0-for-3 from the free throw line. Here's Kai Healy, who got the spot start this morning. Six to shoot. Nice feed inside. And that's Romeo.
That was a good look, though, by Brandon Clark. Just had his head up on the dribble drive into the gap. And that's what Santa Clara has to do. Draw attention to the guards. That'll open up things on the inside.
Okorafor off the mark. Fresh 35 due to that offensive rebound from Matt Lopez, his second, inside. And they wave it off.
Brandon Clark is so important as an offensive player, but also the delivery to his teammate, Romeo.
Okay, all right. Yep. Okay. 3, 2. Just a remarkable and inspiring story. We're all rooting for Andrew Papenfuss. When we come back here at halftime between Ryder and Santa Clara, Tim and I will give you a championship preview of the Orlando Classic. That game coming up between Kansas and Michigan State. Stay with us. This is my son, Teddy Dupont.
It's a good look.
Back here inside HP Fieldhouse on the grounds of the ESPN Wide World of Sports. There is a ton of amateur athletics going on outside. Inside, we are in the consolation round of the Orlando Classic, where right now, with 3:39 to go in the first, Ryder from the MAC leads Santa Clara from the West Coast Conference 20-15, and immediately following our game, Tim, it's going to be Kansas and Michigan State in the championship game, and immediately following the opening of the doors here at the HP Fieldhouse, these seats were flooded by Kansas fans mostly. There are a lot of Michigan State fans here as well, but they're watching bonus basketball right now.
I don't get it. Bill Self's got a great program, and they won 10 straight Big 12 championships. I don't know how he's done it, because they don't have any support. The people don't love the team out there enough. Oh, my goodness, they're great fans. They're the best I've seen. They are so passionate, and they're ready. Actually, I had a kind of a purplish tie on Friday just to try to match your ability to dress at a high level. And a couple of Kansas fans said, why are you wearing a K-State tie? I said, stop. It's only November. Let's not get into Big 12 stuff yet, but they are passionate and fun to be around.
Matt Lopez in double figures, as he has been in all three games in the Orlando Classic. The only Ryder Bronc in double figures. Clark, tough shot. Romeo, offensive rebound. Surrounded by three Ryder Broncs, and he'll go to the line and shoot two.
Dominic Romeo giving Kerry Keating some tough minutes off the bench. Not a guy that gets much run, but came in, throwing his body around, playing hard. Why not on a Sunday morning? He wants some minutes.
And number 35 in white, the 7-footer, Matt Lopez, slapped his hands in frustration a moment ago. That's his second foul. He spent the majority of the first half on the court instead of on the bench. That's a key for Kevin Baggett, but now he's going to have to take a seat.
The problem is that Ryder didn't get in position until the ball came off the rim, and Romeo fought his way for an angle, and now Lopez is on the bench.
Number 32, Kenny Grant, checks in Lopez's stead. 22-16, Ryder with the lead. Here come the Broncos, led by Clark. Tough shot from Brandon Clark. He's missed a couple of those early. Connected on that one off the window.
Running one-hander, Allen Iverson. Look there for the little guy, Clark.
Senior out of East Chicago, Indiana. Sadler cannot buy one.
Shaking his head as he runs back on defense. And you know what? I don't blame him.
Johnson too strong, got his own miss. Tie up with the ball, but no whistle.
Excuse me.
And finally they do, and it's a timeout called by Kerry Keating.
There's a part in the rule book says when two guys both have their hands on the ball, that means you blow the whistle and it's a jump ball. What? These guys have flights this afternoon or what? But you know, this game counts for both teams, and you got to make that call. I mean, this is as easy as it gets, but this is not easy. The degree of difficulty, the little guy playing big off the window, Clark.
Over the outstretched arms of Kenny Grant, didn't matter. And here's the tie-up that we were just talking about a moment ago.
There's one tie-up. There's one. Here's another one. There's another one. Three. Four tie-ups, and by the way, they didn't call the tie-up. They got a timeout call. So they only missed it four times.
Three tie-ups cancels out the jump ball.
The referees get paid today, by the way, in the morning. They get the full fee, even if it's a morning game, just like you.
Tim Flaherty, lead official this afternoon.
I mean, I could see if you missed one, but you can't miss four, can you? They did, though.
They'll have to answer to Tim Welsh after the game.
Well, they have to answer to the two coaches. They're living and dying over there on the sideline for this game. They need a win.
2:05 left, Santa Clara with three timeouts remaining. And a three from Brandon Clark. He now has seven.
He's a good-looking player, Rich. And he can do a lot for Kerry Keating. He's starting to put the team on his back the last part of this half.
Thomas rattles around and out. Ball goes out of bounds. It's going to stay Ryder basketball as we see Junior Fortunat come back in. And Kenny Grant will take a seat. Last couple of minutes without their star 7-footer, Matt Lopez on the bench with two fouls. Here's a catch and shoot. No good. Rebound to Healy. Healy, the rare shot attempt, and he makes the most of it. 3 points for Kai Healy.
Created again on the dribble penetration, threw the defense in, and Santa Clara now sharing the basketball, and Healy had his feet set.
Broncos of Santa Clara back on top by two. 9-0 run in the last couple of minutes. And all of a sudden it's Ryder who can't buy a shot. They're 0-for-10 from 3-point range. That's coming off a 3-for-19 effort from three-point range for Ryder in their previous game.
Well, Brandon Clark can put this team on his back. He's got that ability to knock down shots from the perimeter, but also when he drives into the gut, he is very good drawing the defense. He draws two, and the kick out to Healy slid into that open slot on the outside. And Ryder now playing with renewed, Santa Clara playing with renewed energy on both ends of the floor.
Talk about the baby Bronx from Santa Clara. He's one of a number of freshmen, nine freshmen and sophomores on Kerry Keating's bench. They have a two-point lead under a minute to go. Healy, again, same spot, different result this time.
That's because that one was contested. You're open, that's good, but don't get crazy now. Keep running your offense.
There's Thomas, double team. Still puts it up and gets it to go down.
A strong step through. That's a weight room move, Rich. You got trapped, but it wasn't a strong trap. Stayed strong, kept the ball high, and finished.
Last shot time for the Broncos from Santa Clara. 10 seconds to go in the half. Here's Clark. He gets it to go with 2 seconds left. And Ryder's prayer not answered as the buzzer sounds. And we've got a good one in the seventh place game at the Orlando Classic. We are at halftime, and Santa Clara, courtesy of a late Brandon Clark lay-in, leads it over the Ryder Bronx, 26-24. Back after this. Coming up next, first half highlights and the second half. Welcome back. We're at halftime between Ryder and Santa Clara. Andrew Papenfuss came to Santa Clara as the Broncos' student manager, earned a spot as a walk-on, then was elected team captain this spring. Everything seemed in place for a great senior season until one June day.
Yeah, so I suffered a seizure in June when I was coaching our basketball camp at Santa Clara. I was taken to the hospital, and an MRI revealed that I had a brain, a golf ball-sized tumor. The next day I underwent a biopsy to reveal what the tumor was made of, to figure out if it was cancerous or not cancerous, and luckily it was benign. But they still said it has the chance to grow into an area that would make the tumor either a full removal wouldn't be an option, or it could upregulate and become something worse. So I had a decision. They said it's not imperative that you get it out now, and being a senior, you know, I could play my senior season and then have surgery at the end of it, or I could get it out now and have a chance of coming back, but they said be prepared going into surgery that you may not play again. So I had a very tough decision to make, but I decided ultimately my long-term health was the most important, so I decided to have surgery. So I scheduled it as soon as I could get in up at UCSF, and we went from there. I was going to be awake during surgery because of where the tumor is located. It was next to my motor cortex, so that controls the right side of my body since it was on the left. The tumor's on the left side of my brain. So I went in prepared, just with my family. My parents were there in the morning of. Went in just trying to be relaxed and, you know, just trying to take it as it is. They put me to sleep, cut me open, and then they woke me up so they could make sure they weren't going to take anything important, that I was able to talk, I was able to move my legs, my arms, and they wouldn't remove anything that was important. So they did. They used an electrostimulation to shock different parts of my brain to see if they could get a reaction either in my foot or my hands, and it's called brain mapping. So that's the procedure I underwent. And actually, I suffered a seizure during the procedure, and how they stopped it is that they poured cold water on my brain, but it felt like they were pouring cold water on my leg. So that was a pretty unique experience and sensation, but it kind of felt like I was at the dentist's office. So this Thanksgiving, I'm just thankful for, you know, my ability to remain positive throughout it all, and that positivity stems from not only my family, who's been through everything with me, but my friends, my teammates, the coaching staff, the entire community of Santa Clara, and all overall the bigger network.
Just a remarkable and inspiring story. We're all rooting for Andrew Papenfuss. When we come back here at halftime between Ryder and Santa Clara, Tim and I will give you a championship preview of the Orlando Classic. That game coming up between Kansas and Michigan State. Stay with us. Ellis, Alexander, and then Valentine. Feels like it should be played in March.
You know, Cliff Alexander, Perry Ellis are the key for Kansas. They've played very well at this tournament. But, you know, both teams have really shot the ball well from the outside. And you think of Kansas and Michigan State, you think of rebounding, you think of tough defense, the gritty play in the paint. But really, they're more perimeter-oriented than ever. And even Perry Ellis has done things on the outside. But Cliff Alexander is such an impressive young freshman. Michigan State wants to run up and down the floor. Kansas is going to play a little high-low offense. But Denzel Valentine for Tom Izzo is turning into a special player. He can do a lot of things with the basketball, as we know. Plays a little point forward. Very good passer and highly skilled. But showing the ability to knock down open shots from anywhere on the court. And Michigan State's got some jet quick guards. They're going to push the ball into the gaps. And if they don't slow the guards down, Michigan State will drive to the rim or drive and kick to open shooters. And Valentine is feeling it this weekend in Orlando.
The stars are going to be out. You can tell by all the NBA scouts that are here. But what do you think the key is for each team to pull off a win here?
Well, I think for Kansas, they definitely have to get out on the perimeter and guard Trice and Valentine because they're inside guys. Dawson has been a little bit ill this weekend. I look for him to break out a little bit more. But I think Kansas is going to try to wear out Michigan State. They have more depth, especially on the front line. They're going to try to go inside to Alexander and Ellis.
Well, it's only late November, but it certainly feels like it should be late March or maybe even early April. It's going to be Kansas and Michigan State for the championship in the Orlando Classic. That's coming up at 1 p.m. Eastern on ESPN. We're back with more here at halftime after this. Jen. I don't know if you want me to tee you up on this or I'll mention it. I'd rather you mention it, but I think both of the games that we had with Ryder, right? Was it Santa Clara? Santa Clara had huge droughts to start the second half, didn't they?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Just about set for the start of the second half of this seventh place consolation game between the Santa Clara Bronx and the Ryder Bronx. 26-24, Santa Clara from the West Coast Conference in the lead over the Bronx from the MAC. Rich Hollenberg, Tim Welsh back set for the second half inside HP Fieldhouse. It was a well-played first half and a close first half. Both teams had a couple of key guys who led the way for it.
Well, it was well played on the defensive end of the floor. I think both teams got after it. They're playing with a little bit of desperation. Offensively, it's been a little bit ugly. Matt Lopez, though, continues to be a go-to guy for Ryder, a guy in the middle of the floor they can throw to. And Ryder has been challenged to match up with him because of their lack of size, Santa Clara. But Ryder has been able to get the ball to him, not only in transition, but against the 2-3 zone. They've spaced the floor around Lopez, and he's been very effective. And Santa Clara, Brandon Clark, has shown why he is one of the better guards in the West Coast Conference, because he has the ability to create off the bounce, not only for himself from the perimeter. He knows how to spot up from deep range, but he's also an unselfish player who can dribble drive into the gaps, make things happen. Ryder has to find a way to slow him down, keep the ball out of his hands. Easier said than done, because he's a special player.
Both teams not shooting it well from the field, but a very highly competitive first half. And the one thing that really jumps out at you, obviously, with all other numbers being equal, Tim, the fact that Ryder cannot buy a three-point basket. They are 0 for 11 from long distance. And specifically, Zedrick Sadler has no points in this game. And even from close range, the easy shots aren't falling for him.
Yeah, you feel for the young man just because of the fact that he's playing very hard. He's taking some pretty good shots. And half those shots went halfway down and just bounced out. So Ryder's kept their composure. They just got to keep doing what they do offensively and making sure Lopez stays on the floor.
First few minutes of this second half are going to be key, with Santa Clara falling victim to some extended droughts at the start of the second half of both of their previous Orlando Classic games. And Healy misses the first shot to start off. Okorafor tried to force it inside, picked off by Hubbard.
It's too tight in there. Okorafor needs to look for his shot. He dribbled right into the middle of the floor. He didn't look at the rim.
Brownridge. Hubbard for three. Yes, the big man.
Well, that's a great sign for Santa Clara, because they have struggled in this tournament to coming out of the locker room in the second half. Big droughts against both Tennessee and Rhode Island. 9-plus minutes in both games without a point. Right out of the gate, Albert says, I'll take care of that with a three.
There's Sadler. Still can't buy one. Chased down by Taylor, but it's out of bounds. Good hustle by number three in white. It'll be Santa Clara basketball.
Well, Matt Hubbard's a freshman. The Carrickeen thought he was just going to bring along nicely off the bench, but he's not going to be able to do that. He's going to get the major minutes. And here on the dribble handoff and the driving kick, nice look pitch back by Brownridge. And Hubbard had his feet set to knock it in.
Brownridge started this game with back-to-back threes. He's been quiet since. Clark with 9 points in the first half. Here's Brownridge, hand in his face, doesn't matter. Third three-pointer for Jared Brownridge, and he has 9.
Well, solid offense right now for Santa Clara, sharing the basketball, spacing it, reversing the floor, patience, finding the open man.
Largest lead for Santa Clara. It's 8. They're in the midst of a 9-0 run. Thomas, nice take.
That's what he does. He's got that step through move, but now on the jog back. Right, Santa Clara on the attack.
Brownridge trying it again. No good this time. Thomas clears. Good hands by Healy. Good hustle as well. He goes out of bounds. Checks with one of the photographers that he knocked over. Everybody's okay. That's the good news.
Well, Khalil Thomas, if he just takes one more dribble down towards the baseline, that improves that passing angle into Matt Lopez. Well, Thomas comes out of the game quickly. I don't know if he's gassed or missed a defensive assignment, but he's played very well for Ryder in this tournament.
Ryder has the ball. They're in the white home uniforms. Nice spin move. Jimmy Taylor has his fourth point of the afternoon.
Well, when your shots keep missing from the perimeter, you've got to mix up your game, and now Ryder attacking on the rim.
Brownridge. That's his first bucket from close range, and he leads with 11 points.
Santa Clara, good job on the rush back after the made bucket by Ryder, just pushing it before they could set their defense.
Jared Brownridge had a 38-point effort in a game last year, averaging only 11 so far this season. He's got 11 today. Lundy short. See if they get it to Brownridge again. Ride the hot hand. Here he is, 23 in red. Clark calls his own number and knocks it down. That's his second triple, and he leads all scorers with 12.
Well, you can forget about droughts coming out of the second half. I have to talk about that anymore. With Ryder, 11 points in less than 4 minutes.
And the rebound by Clark. Big look up ahead as Hubbard leaked out. But he missed the bunny. Santa Clara's been on fire to start the second half. Whistle on the floor. 37-28 lead for the Broncos out of the West Coast Conference with 15:57 to go.
Well, Santa Clara couldn't score. Tried to buy one the first two games coming out of the locker room, but they are on fire now with the little guy from downtown, Brandon Clark. Oh, slowly good.
Vitale, meaning you're gonna shoot him or he's joining us?
Yes, how are you? Yes. Good, now how's everything with you? Oh, good, well, thank you, yeah. Everything good? Where are you living? Oh, still good, yeah.
How you doing, my friend?
Oh, good, great. I'll tell him I'm sorry, I'm gonna call him later today. Great seeing you, thanks for saying hello, you too.
Beautiful.
I sent Lorraine my address. Thank you. Oh.
Give Well, that's a familiar face for anybody who has any interest in the sport of college basketball. One of the true great ambassadors of the sport. Who is
that
Dick
guy?
Vitale?
Who is it? I can't tell who that is from behind.
He can't go anywhere without being treated to handshakes, back slaps, pictures, kisses. An iconic figure in our sport.
Saw him yesterday wandering around the lobby. He said he wanted directions to the pool. He said, how's the pool here? I said, thick. This is a business trip, man. No pool. We're in the room watching tape, doing our boards. Got producers calling us to give them stuff all the time. Joe McCoy's always grinding us 24-7. No time for the pool.
Dick will be calling the championship game with our colleague Dave O'Brien coming up at 1 Eastern on ESPN. Dick's got a new book out, too, called It's Awesome, Baby. And all the proceeds go to cancer research, as usual. Not only terrific in the sport of college basketball, but in raising funds and awareness to fight the battle of cancer. Unbelievable.
No one's done it better, that's for sure. Well, coming out of that timeout, it was a nice move by Lundy at the rim, giving Ryder a little bit of promise offensively.
Santa Clara, who against Tennessee and Rhode Island went almost 10 minutes at the start of each second half without scoring, has come out blazing in this second half. They led it by 2 at the half. They lead it by 7 now, 15-18 to go. Nice take by Brandon Clark. He has a game-high 14. It's a 9-point lead.
He's taking it. He is taking the ball and being aggressive. And that's what Kerry Keating wants and needs from Brandon Clark.
There's Lopez. 10 on the shot clock. 5 to shoot. Gonna have to hustle. Taylor forced it up. Lundy almost came away with the rebound, but it went out of bounds. It'll be Santa Clara basketball.
Santa Clara very good defensively on that possession, Rich. They were long and active with their hands, getting into the passing lanes. Their shifts were very quick, their bumps in their zone, and Ryder just couldn't find any openings in the gaps.
Clark. Wash. Johnson. Offensive rebound is in. That's Evan Wardlow's first 2 of the afternoon.
A lot of good energy on the backside, and Kerry Keating pushing all the right buttons. His bench giving them a lift.
The best scoring backcourt in the West Coast Conference has shown that today, with Clark and Brownridge combining for 25 points so far. Lopez can't come up with it. Here comes Clark. The long bounce pass, but it's picked off by Ryder. Scramble for the ball. It's going to be possession arrow, Ryder Bronx. Number 14 in white, Sean Valentine, set to check back in for Kevin Baggett. Xavier Lundy will go to the bench.
Now Brandon Clark, everything's been built around him today. Kerry Keating, you are all over the floor. You need a couple minutes just to, before the 12 and under timeout. He'll get him right back in, but that's a good coaching move. Give him a quick break.
And now Clark will take a quick breather. So that means Edwards will be running the point, and we'll see if they look to focus on Jared Brownridge on the offensive end for Santa Clara. Valentine, 3. Yes. Sean Valentine's first points of the afternoon.
What a solid offense by Ryder on that position, because Santa Clara, they're unyielding right now on the defensive end. That switching back to a man, trying to keep Ryder off balance. Valentine giving him a little bit of light.
almost throw it away. Johnson controls. 10 on the shot clock. 5 to shoot. Johnson. Too much dribbling. 1 on the clock. And we've got a shot clock violation. Good defense by Ryder and the 8th turnover by Santa Clara.
That's why. Excuse me, go ahead, Rich.
I was going to ask you, now that Ryder's taken over on offense, why haven't they been able to focus on Matt Lopez, who was so successful in the first half?
Well, I think it's because Santa Clara's perimeter defense has been up into Ryder's guards, and their skill level is probably not what it needs to be able to break people down off the dribble and still be able to make that nice delivery inside. They've got to try to open up the floor. And, you know, when you can't knock down shots, then your defense is just going to shrink on the inside.
Here's D'Orazio for three. Sadler, no. Johnson comes away with it. Well, Ryder does have one make from distance, but they are 1-for-14 from three-point range in this game. Brownridge, floater, yes. Showing the repertoire. Jared Brownridge has 13.
Clark and Brownridge are keepers in the West Coast Conference. He'll be a real good backcourt in that league. And these three games this weekend are helping Kara Keating develop a little bit of a bench around his two special guards.
Valentine. Short on that three attempt. D'Orazio gets the offensive board. Fresh 35. And there's a triple from number three, Jimmy Taylor.
Well, I like what Anthony D'Orazio has given Kevin Baggett off the bench. Just a lot of energy and toughness. That play was made by his ability to scratch out that rebound.
Ryder within 7. Healy, he can shoot that. And a little indecision on Kai Healy's part forces the 9th Santa Clara turnover.
Santa Clara came out of the locker room ready, and their two guards, Brandon Clark and this man, Jared Brownridge, with the little leaner over the top.
Team is this? Rhode Island? Okay. That's pretty cool they get that shot. Is that our cameras or is that Disney? Yeah. That's cool.
So how was it, guys?
Nope. Where is she? She's not even here. What's her story? Yeah, it's okay. Rock and roller coaster, you said, and the Tower of Terror. Yeah, I'm fine. Yep. Mr. Everything, Dave Warlock, playing stage manager. Well, players from Santa Clara and Rhode Island enjoying the day off yesterday at the Disney parks. The Bronx went for a spin on the Rock and Roller Coaster starring Aerosmith. And obviously they were no worse for wear after that. They're playing well this afternoon. And for the Rams, well, they dropped in on the Tower of Terror, one of my personal favorites. And I know my producer Joe McCoy enjoyed the park yesterday. He hit all these rides at least a couple of times after he did all his homework for today's games, of course. Look at that drop inside the Tower of Terror. We'll be seeing Rhode Island taking on Georgia Tech in the consolation bracket later on at 6:30 tonight. But some of these guys have to duck their heads to make sure they don't get a bump.
If you don't play defense for Dan Hurley, you go through the Tower of Terror back in Kingston,
that's
Rhode
right.
Island. So They're used to that.
Yeah, that's a different tower up there. EC Matthews, a real fun player to watch for the Rams. We'll see him later on ESPNU at 6:30 Eastern.
Santa Clara, again, changing defenses, trying to keep Ryder off balance and just daring them to shoot from three with changing back to the zone.
There's a touch from Lopez. They need to do that more often.
Well, again, it's easier said than done because Santa Clara's packing it in, but that time Ryder did a nice job spacing the floor, and the big fella just carved it up right in the middle of the lane.
Healy goes left. Clark's back in. Hubbard, three. We saw one he made earlier. He missed that one.
That time he was covered, though. He's got to pick and choose, make sure he plays inside as well.
Another touch for Lopez. He can't get it to go, but the follow from Valentine.
And that's what happens. I mean, Lopez draws so much attention. Everybody turned towards him, and on the backside, no one blocked out Valentine.
Valentine had 9 against Georgia Tech on Friday. It's a 10-2 Ryder run. They are right back in this thing. It's a one-possession ball game. Santa Clara 43, Ryder 40. 9:46 to go. And Khalil Thomas will check back in for Kevin Baggett's club. Here's Brownridge. Yes. Any thoughts of an extended Santa Clara drought have been squelched by number 23 in red.
Well, they did a good job on the throwback there, but on that possession. But Khalil Thomas just standing and not closing out on the perimeter. And he will come out of the game because that's just lazy defense by Ryder.
Here's Lopez, this time on the left block. Good hands by Clark, but they get a foul. 9:09 to go in this contest. Immediately following over on ESPN, it will be a battle of titans in college basketball, and Tom Izzo leading one of them in. Beautiful sunshine outside Walt Disney World, but it's all business for Tom Izzo and his Michigan State Spartans. He's 4-1 all time against the Jayhawks and would love nothing more than to go 5-1 and take home an Orlando Classic Championship back to East Lansing. Thomas, it's another one of those weight room buckets.
Ah, he's very explosive at the rim. They just got to tighten up their game on this end of the floor. Good help there on the baseline drive to Clark.
Brownridge again, 18. Make it 19 with that three-pointer for Jared Brownridge. He has 5 of those today.
Kevin Baggs got to tell his team on the next under-8 timeout, listen, there's two guys that can beat us. It's Clark and Brownridge, so you have to pay attention to him. And when Clark dribbles into the gap, you have to know where he is, but you better be ready to close out on Brownridge on the weak side.
Lopez, double-teamed. Found the open man, Taylor. And Taylor knocks down the three. Both teams shooting it well in the last few minutes. And Tim, Jared Brownridge coming into this tournament was the one name that we kept hearing of from out of the people of Santa Clara, and he's living up to that reputation.
He's a good-looking sophomore, but it starts with the little guy Clark. He draws the defense, and on the weak side, nice kick out. Locking it down for Santa Clara.
Copy that.
Row A, you want a free oil change courtesy of Tires Plus. Once again, our lucky row is
Is this the running one?
Congratulations, everyone.
Yeah, wait, this doesn't look like the running one. Okay. Run Disney.
Got it.
Well, there is so much to do at the ESPN Wide World of Sports for all amateur athletics, one of the premier sporting grounds in the country, if not the world. Whether it's lacrosse, volleyball, track and field, gymnastics, of course, Pop Warner football, field hockey, soccer, baseball, you name it. And of course, basketball. ESPN Wide World of Sports is a dream come true for amateur athletics. We get the great opportunity to see it firsthand every time we're here at the Orlando Classic, Tim, and it never fails to amaze us, not only the sheer volume of youngsters that show up for these tournaments, but the quality of play as well.
Well, absolutely. And, you know, both teams trying to scratch and claw here in the last 8-14, grinding out. Been kind of an ebb and flow of runs, but I think both teams are focused now defensively. They've settled in defensively. Ryder has to keep track of Clark and Brownridge.
They've combined for 33 points this afternoon. Jared Brownridge leading all scorers with 19. Here's Clark from the corner. In and out. And a Santa Clara foul on the rebound. It'll be Ryder basketball when we come back. Media timeout, 7:48 to go in this seventh place game at the Orlando Classic. The Santa Clara Broncos lead it by 4. Well, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I have 5 threes and 2 other buckets. Am I right? I go with Warlock. He says we're right. Bill Self walking into the HP Fieldhouse. 10 consecutive Big 12 regular season titles, looking to make it 11 this year, and a tough test in the early non-conference schedule for Self and the Jayhawks as they have to take on Tom Izzo and the Michigan State Spartans. That's coming up at 1 Eastern, immediately following this game you're watching now. That game will be played on ESPN. 11th-ranked Jayhawks, 20th-ranked Spartans. Going to be a good one.
Well, Kansas never shies away from scheduling at the beginning of the season. I don't know, they got whacked pretty good, whacked around by Kentucky, but I think the panic in the air in Lawrence is gone because they've been very impressive this weekend, developing a bench, trying to implement some of their youngsters into the lineup, and as you said, it'll be a dogfight at 1 p.m. today.
Maybe those Jayhawk fans, especially the ones who have shown up en masse in Orlando, could take a page from Aaron Rodgers, the quarterback for the Packers. R-E-L-A-X. And there's a T-H-R-E-E from Jimmy Taylor. His third three of the second half.
Well, Kevin Baggett says finally we're starting to loosen up on the offensive end. And it's really been a one-man band offensively. Just throw it into Lopez and hope he can do something with it. Because their guards just couldn't buy one. But
better shot selection last few possessions by Ryder.
Sadler and Thomas to the bench. Valentine D'Orazio in. It's a one-point game. Santa Clara with the lead and the ball. Hubbard off the window. Nice feed, too. He's in double digits with 10.
Nice delivery off the bounce by Brownridge into the gap and getting a little bit more comfortable and fluid with their chemistry on the offensive end, Santa Clara with Hubbard.
Ryder inching back into this game with an 18-10 run after trailing by 11. Tied up. Possession arrow of Santa Clara. And neither player wants to give up the basketball. I'd vote for Matt Lopez in that one. We're going to call a foul. It's going to go on Santa Clara's Brandon Clark. And that's his third foul.
Matt Lopez comes out of the game, but when the guards dribble drive into the gaps, they have to be aware if the defense really shrinks on the inside, especially around Lopez, they got to kick it back outside. That's when they'll get their open looks on the three-point line.
Taylor maybe falling in love with the three a little too much.
Now, especially 34 seconds on the shot clock.
Nice give. But Valentine can't find the bottom of the bucket. Here's Brownridge.
That was a good cut to the rim by Valentine. Just a little off balance as the finish couldn't finish.
Under 6 minutes to go. Both teams looking to leave Orlando with a win. 10 on the shot clock. Clark and one.
I was about to say way too much dribbling by Santa Clara. Brownridge took about 15 dribbles in place on the perimeter, but he was waiting for something to happen and gave it up to Clark. He found a gap, found an angle into the middle, and looked like D'Orazio was there on time. And from that angle, tough to tell if he had legal guarding position. It looked like a charge to me.
Brandon Clark coming in, an 80% free throw shooter. Good on that one. He has 17 to go along with his backcourt mates, 19 points. Jared Brownridge and Brandon Clark combining for 36 points this afternoon. Add Hubbard into the mix, and that's 46 of Santa Clara's 54 points today. A three-headed monster for the Broncos. Thomas, off the back iron. Fresh 35 from D'Orazio, and he nails the three.
He should get the three. He flew in there, got that offensive rebound, and he's giving them a lot of energy off the bench.
The hops of Denzel Johnson saved that ball from going out of bounds. Brownridge guarded by Okorafor. And they're going to get Valentine with the foul on the hedge.
Well, Anthony D'Orazio has done a lot of different things today for Ryder, but scratched in to get the offensive rebound and just got his feet set. Actually gave up his body on the possession before and tried to take a charge on Clark. Right now Ryder feisty on the defensive end, and they're giving Lopez some minutes off for the stretch run.
Ryder missed their first 13 three attempts. Since then, though, Tim, 5 of 8.
Better selection. Sometimes you get a couple to fall, everybody gets confident.
Clark. Yes. He's silky smooth.
He is, but he's going by the guards on the dribble. Someone's got to step up a lot sooner when he dribble drives into the gap, gets that angle. You can't let him get into the paint and square up because he is very good from that mid-range.
Santa Clara up by five, coming up on 4 minutes to go. Thomas spins right off the window. Pretty move from Khalil Thomas. He's in double digits with 10.
I like Valentine and Thomas and Lopez, three good inside players for Kevin Baggett. You know, Ryder getting a little bit of confidence and a flow offensively.
Brownridge for three. Yes! Game high 22 for Jared Brownridge and 6 3-pointers.
Well, that's just a defensive mistake by Teddy Okorafor. He just watched the dribbler into the middle of the floor. He was playing in no man's land and lost track of where Brownridge was on the perimeter. And Brandon Clark, just a great sense of the teammate sliding into that slot on the wing.
Okorafor struggling today offensively. He's scoreless. Kind of getting the sense with 3 minutes left, these are more representative performances of what these teams are going to show in conference play.
Well,
yes?
You hope so, or maybe they're just kind of at each other's level, but they're playing hard. That's the thing. You can see a little desperation on both teams. And defensively, they both played pretty tough, but right now, Brandon Clark has been too much for Ryder to handle.
Five to shoot. Clark in the corner. Johnson's going to have to put it up, and he doesn't do it in time. Shot clock violation. It'll be Ryder basketball on the 10th Santa Clara turnover of the afternoon.
Brandon Clark can get by you with either hand. He's got the floater. Nice touch, good feel on the mid-range, and then if the defense does come and help, he finds his partner in the backcourt. Jared Brownridge, lock it down for Santa Clara.
Got it. I'm actually shocked that there are empty seats right now. Love that bracket. 2:33 to go. It's a two-possession ball game. Santa Clara Broncos 59, the Ryder Bronx 53. And coming into this tournament, we knew that Brownridge and Clark were the highest scoring backcourt in the West Coast Conference last year. They've shown it today.
Well, they can dribble drive in the gaps. They look for each other. They're trying to be more aggressive because Kerry Keating wants them to really put the team on their backs. And it starts with Clark dribble driving into the gaps, finding his teammates, but Brownridge also the ability to slide and move, not stand, but find that open angle off the penetration into the gaps by Clark.
We're going to see some great guard play coming up immediately following this game at 1 Eastern on ESPN, Kansas and Michigan State. Travis Trice, one of the leaders. He's got a good backup point guard in Tum Tum Nairn, who we saw on Thursday. Preternaturally mature for a freshman, one of the great young leaders on this new Spartans club. There's a nice take from Taylor. He has 15.
Well, he settled into this game. He made a couple shots from the perimeter, done a better job of just taking what the defense gives them. But now they've got to try to lock down on Clark and know where Brownridge is on the perimeter.
Hubbard shot fake. Bodies fly, and we're going the other way.
It's just a major freshman mistake. Hubbard going a little bit too fast. And don't give him the ball where he can't do anything with it. He got caught with the ball in the corner, and he's got to get it back out to his guards, not try to dribble drive from the corner all the way to the rim. That's not going to happen.
Time is a factor. Counting down to 1.5 minutes left. Ryder trails by four. Inside, Lopez, left hand.
Well, perfect delivery. Making sure he catches it. He can finish it quickly in traffic.
Timeout Santa Clara. Matt Lopez has tied his career high with 14. That career high was set in game one of this Orlando Classic tournament.
Lopez not only, Rich, finds a way to post up well, but he has a good feel for his guards. And here on the D'Orazio pitch down low, he gives a little body bump to Hubbard, and D'Orazio, the perfect delivery where he can just catch it at the chest and lay it in.
1:24 left. Take us inside each huddle, Tim. First for Santa Clara. What do you think Kerry Keating's telling his club right now?
Well, you know, you want to be patient, but you've got to find a way for Clark to be involved and make sure after he gives it up that he gets it back, because he's going to be able to get into the gaps and make things happen. I mean, that's how Matt Hubbard and, of course, Brownridge on the perimeter, but guys like Matt Hubbard will benefit off movement from Clark with the basketball. And then defensively, you know, what's Ryder going to do? Well, they have to make sure they give help but also stay stuck on the perimeter to Brownridge, not give any help off him, because those are the two guys really that can beat you for Santa Clara.
Next up for Santa Clara, they're going to be on the road at San Jose State, but at least they get to be back in their home state. And then when you talk about the Ryder Bronx, and we've talked about how tough the MAC conference is, they open up MAC play December 7th, early for most conferences, and they have to take on Siena.
Well, Siena's one of the favorites coming into this season. They return all the players from a year ago when they won the CBI, and Manhattan is very good. They lost on a heartbreaker at George Mason last night. Iona is always good, as we know. Monmouth is much improved. They got a tough game. They played Maryland tough on the road the other night. They have a tough game tonight at SMU. And St. Peter's beat Rutgers on the road earlier this year.
.115 to go. Santa Clara with the ball and the lead. .10 Clark. And they call the foul on Ryder. It's going to go on number 3 in white, Jimmy Taylor, his third.
Well, you knew what he was going to do, and Ryder was ready. They just didn't step up in time. And it looks like, you know, Clark is very good at getting there. And just Taylor was sliding just ever so much just to not get the call. But good effort by Taylor, but Clark just too tough to handle off the bounce.
Brandon Clark has a career high of 32 to his credit in his career, the senior, averaging 17.5 this season so far, and 80% from the free throw line.
Gary Keating went into the state of Indiana and stole one, and Brandon Clark, he is a heck of a player.
He now has 20 points to go along with 5 rebounds and 6 assists. Just another day at the office for Brandon Clark, now 21. And he and Brownridge have combined for 43 points on the afternoon. 1:01 left, 4-point lead for Santa Clara. What do you look for here from Ryder?
Well, they've got to try to get Lopez a touch, and if the defense collapses, he'll kick it back out. Maybe they can get Taylor a three. If not, they can't be too selective now. There's under 20 on the shot clock.
Here's the lob in. They converge on it. Santa Clara almost came away with it, but Jared Brownridge out of bounds.
Well, Kevin Baggett's got 3 timeouts. I would use one right now. There's only 39 seconds to go, and you know, Lopez, the house is around him and surrounded.
I'm surprised that Ryder didn't call a timeout. With three timeouts left, this is do-or-die possession.
Here's Sadler. Maybe the unlikeliest of shooters who struggled all afternoon, hasn't had a bucket. And Brownridge steals it. Up and in for Jared Brownridge. A highlight as the exclamation point on an outstanding afternoon for the sophomore.
Well, it was a four-point game, and Ryder decided to play it out, and I was very surprised, and they just threw it away, and Santa Clara just with the dagger off the steal. A great finish by Brownridge.
On a Sunday afternoon with Kansas, Michigan State looming ahead of us and a full slate of football games from the NFL, might be tough to crack the SportsCenter top 10 on a Sunday, but Jared Brownridge just put up a highlight for sure. left. Now up to a 7-point lead for Santa Clara as Brownridge goes to the bench. And there's a three. And a timeout call.
Well, Ryder hanging tough, and Santa Clara just backed away. Got to come out and guard on the perimeter, but they'll be guarding here in about 45 minutes. Kansas and Michigan State, you better guard from the perimeter because both teams have shot the ball extremely well this weekend in Orlando.
Both teams featuring some impressive young talent too. Cliff Alexander coming off the bench right now. Surprisingly, Kelly Oubre hasn't played much at all for Bill Self, but you know once they get into the teeth of Big 12 play, he's going to come along nicely. And for Michigan State, we've been impressed with Marvin Clark.
Marvin Clark has been outstanding, but Denzel Valentine has been the guy. He just has that presence about him out on the floor. He's playing with jet quick guards, but he also can handle, distribute, and he has shot the ball big time.
4-point game, 14.2 to go. Santa Clara with the ball. And there was a foul called before the inbounds.
Well, Sadler just wrapped up Clark, and if you're going to foul someone before the ball comes inbounds, I would not say that Brandon Clark would be my choice.
A couple of head-scratching decisions on the side of the Ryder Bronx in the closing moments of this game sends Brandon Clark to the line. And he's perfect from the free throw line today. That's now 4 for 4. He has 22.
Well, you have to give your pressure a little bit of a chance to see how Santa Clara is going to react. I don't think you foul the best player on the floor in an automatic free throw shooter before the ball even comes in bounds.
23 for Clark, 25 for Brownridge. That's been the story for Santa Clara. Counting down, 10 seconds remaining. Sadler, no good. And the Santa Clara Broncos will fly back to California with an impressive win under their belts. They had to wait till Sunday to get it, but they got it nonetheless. They'll improve to 3-4 on the season with 2.9 left and a 6-point lead. And now Jared Brownridge at the line looking to add to his 25 points.
Well, this is how Santa Clara is going to have to get wins this year, is with Clark and Brownridge, and today they did. They were aggressive. They hunted their own shots, but they also got their teammates involved. And Hubbard gave them some nice minutes, and Kai Healy did some good things. Wardlow did. Romeo came in the first half and played with a lot of toughness, so it was a good gut check win for Kerry Keating.
10 points for Hubbard. But the bulk of the scoring came from the backcourt. 27 for Jared Brownridge. And the Santa Clara Broncos win it by a final of 68-60 over the Ryder Bronx. So for Tim Welsh, I'm Rich Hollenberg saying so long from the Orlando Classic, where your final again is 68-60. To watch this entire game on replay, as well as other games, go to watchespn.com or download the Watch ESPN app.